The horseless carriage had always been a human dream. Horses, despite their utility, weren't ideal for pulling carriages for extensive periods, being somewhat unreliable and dangerous, and they also emitted foul odors. Thus, the first automobile emerged at the end of the 15th century, and humanity's initial creation was unbelievably ingenious. It was the clockwork car, created by Leonardo da Vinci. Since it had to be wound every 15 minutes, it naturally lacked practicality. However, the idea of using a machine instead of a horse as a power source is undoubtedly the precursor that led to the automobiles we have today. The quest for a carriage that was tireless, manageable, and odorless persisted. 100 years later, a wind-powered vehicle using sails was introduced, but it had its limitations. It was at the mercy of the wind's direction, and on calm days, it was immobile. Another century went by, giving rise to the steam-powered car, which was so hefty that steering it was nearly impossible. Jumping ahead another 100 years to the close of the 19th century, a truly practical automobile came into existence, courtesy of Karl Benz from Germany, who triumphed in creating a gasoline-powered car. Germany has since upheld its prestigious position in the automotive world, home to legendary brands like Benz, BMW, and Audi, maintaining its status as the premier automobile-producing country without interruption. What set Germany apart? Let's unravel some fascinating early innovations that transformed Germany into an automotive juggernaut. Britain's missteps. Germany was, in fact, quite fortunate. Had Britain not implemented the cumbersome Red Flag Act, Germany might not have had its opportunity. After the Industrial Revolution, Britain entered the age of steam automobiles. However, these cars weren't warmly welcomed anywhere. They were noisy, emitted smoke, and were prone to causing injuries, earning them the fearful nickname of running monsters among the citizens. The opposition from the carriage industry was especially fierce. At the time, carriages were the primary means of public transportation, carrying the most people. Steam automobiles were over twice as fast as carriages, and could carry more than double the passengers, all while charging only half the fare. The emerging railway industry also wasn't pleased with the advent of these competitive vehicles, fearing job losses. This led to various regulations being imposed on automobiles. The British Parliament, for starters, increased the toll for automobiles to more than 10 times that of carriages. In cities, cars weren't allowed to travel faster than carriages. The pinnacle of these regulations was the Red Flag Act. A flagman carrying a red flag had to walk 60 yards ahead of the car, and if a carriage appeared, he would signal the driver to stop the car to prevent horses from getting scared. Despite controversies over excessive regulation, this law persisted for a whopping 31 years, during which the British automobile industry utterly collapsed. The engineers who lost their jobs instead of the coachmen moved to the United States, Germany, and France. This migration allowed these countries to rapidly narrow the technological gap and boost their own automobile industries. Even today, the Red Flag Act is cited as a notorious example of foolish regulations that stifled an industry. The world's first female driver, Bertha Benz. The world's first car created by Karl Benz was named the Patent Motor Wagon. It was a three-wheeled, two-seater vehicle equipped with a gasoline engine. However, this historic car initially received as cold a reception as it did in Britain, often dismissed as a smelly old junk. Discouraged by criticism, Benz hesitated to unveil the car to the world. Seeing this, his wife, Bertha Benz, left a note saying she was visiting her parents and secretly took the car with her two sons. Back then, roads were terribly rough and muddy, forcing them to push the car at times. During the journey, a chain broke, and they resorted to using leather from a shoe as a replacement. When they ran out of fuel, they stopped by pharmacies to purchase Ligroin to refill the tank. After a challenging journey, Bertha Benz successfully traveled 66 miles from Mannheim to Pforzheim. News of her accomplishment spread across Germany, shaping a perception that Benz's car was safe enough for even a woman and children to travel long distances. Consequently, orders for Benz's cars began to flow in. Bertha Benz, having played a crucial role in popularizing the Benz automobile, left her mark as the world's first female driver and test driver. The pharmacy where she bought the fuel, Stadtapotheke Wiesloch, is still in operation today and is commemorated as the world's first filling station, becoming a pilgrimage site for automobile enthusiasts. The people's car, Volkswagen. Adolf Hitler rose to the position of Chancellor of Germany in 1933. At that time, owning a car was an unimaginable luxury for the average person. Moreover, Germany was economically devastated, burdened with massive reparations payments due to its defeat in World War I. However, Hitler pledged, everyone should own a car. This was a political strategy to gain popularity among the people and to showcase German ingenuity and the superiority of the Aryan race to the world. People globally and even within Germany thought Hitler was mad, and very few believed it could happen. But Hitler commissioned automobile engineer Dr. Ferdinand Porsche to develop the people's car. Hitler's requirements were extremely demanding. The car had to accommodate a family of five, be able to reach speeds of 62 miles per hour, have an engine that wouldn't freeze in winter, be easy to maintain, and be able to travel more than 8.7 miles on a quarter gallon of gas. The most challenging requirement was the price, which should not exceed 1,000 Reichsmarks, making it affordable, almost equivalent to the price of a motorcycle. Meeting these insane criteria, after 3 years of research, the famous Volkswagen was born. In German, Volkswagen means the people's car. To make the car affordable, Hitler encouraged people to save by buying saving stamps each week for 4 years. So how many people ended up owning this people's car? None, because Hitler started World War II in the meantime. The money saved by hundreds of thousands of people through stamps went directly into war expenses, and the Volkswagen was repurposed for military use. After the war, Dr. Porsche was arrested as a war criminal and served 2 years in a Dijon prison in France. Despite this, the development of the people's car dramatically advanced Germany's automotive technology. The Volkswagen, mockingly called the Beetle by Americans due to its resemblance to a bug, became the best-selling car worldwide due to its practicality. Consequently, Germany earned recognition as the land of automobiles by the world. The Autobahn, propelling Germany forward. The reason behind Germany's construction of the Autobahn, their famous highway system, was to alleviate unemployment. Over 6 million people were jobless due to reparations after World War I and the impacts of the Great Depression. Construction began during the 1920s in the Weimar Republic era, continued under the Nazis, and today it stretches over about 8,000 miles across Germany, with about 70% of it having no speed limit. The Autobahn played a hidden yet pivotal role in elevating the German automotive industry to its current stature. On the Autobahn, a speed competition unfolded among German cars. If a car lagged in speed, it faced immediate rejection from consumers. Therefore, German cars had to excel in performance, focusing intensely on producing vehicles capable of high speeds. Cars had to be robust to handle fast corners and simultaneously maintain durability and safety. Typically, German cars are known for their heavy steering and firm ride. These characteristics were shaped by the necessity of maintaining safety while traveling at speeds over 124 miles per hour on the Autobahn. In reality, there's substantial criticism that the Autobahn didn't fulfill its initial goal of alleviating unemployment. Some argue it was rather a waste of money due to the lack of traffic. However, the continuous and rigorous evaluations German cars received from daily users on the Autobahn acted as a crucial factor in enhancing the quality and performance of German automobiles. An anticipated crisis. German cars hit a historic high in sales last year. However, less than a year later, a sense of crisis pervades, placing the entire German auto industry at a life and death crossroads. Germany, intoxicated by its past success, has been slow to transition to electric vehicles. Its IT and software are far behind competitors, and its batteries, the heart of EVs, are still in the early stages. This has led to a drastic decline in sales in China, Germany's largest market, starting this year. Automobiles have accounted for over 15% of Germany's exports. Nearly a million top-level engineers work not just in car manufacturing companies, but also in globally renowned parts companies like Bosch, Continental, and ZF. Electric cars require less than half the components needed in internal combustion engine cars. which makes a massive unemployment crisis seem inevitable if the current trend continues. According to an agreement with the EU, Germany must phase out all internal combustion engines by 2035. The countdown has begun. Can Germany, which has dominated the automobile market for over 100 years, overcome this crisis? It's another crucial aspect to watch in the global landscape.